So I'm going to start talking so that we can give our presenter the time that they're allowed and tell you about all the great things that are happening. The title of our second session is Understanding Market Barriers and Opportunities. We are really fortunate to have Dr. Lucas Patzek here. He is the director of WSU Thurston County Extension. He's been working on some very exciting research on market opportunities in Thurston, Lewis, and Mason counties that might have direct applicability here in Pierce County as the county moves forward to build a vibrant farm system. So with that, I will introduce Dr. Patzek.
Thank you, folks. Thanks for inviting me. And by the very full room, it's very clear that there's a lot of value to just coming together every once in a while as farmers and talking things over. And that's kind of part of what I'm going to talk about here today. So we did something called the South Sound Food System Initiative, which was partially funded by the Community Foundation of the South Sound. And I partnered with Sarah Rocker, who's a grad student at Evergreen State College, Lisa Smith, who runs an agripreneur ag business training program, and two folks who are kind of starting up something like a food hub in our area, Peter Witt and Tracy Krieger. And basically, this was kind of a three-part thing that we did. So what happened was I came from Skagit County, woefully ignorant of the South Sound food system. And I'm sorry, but I'm going to call South Sound right now Thurston, Lewis, Mason. I know Pierce County is a part of this, and we hope to be a bigger part of things in the future. But basically, what we did was first month on the job, I got approached by the Port of Olympia to meet with the Port Commission, and they wanted to know what's going on with ag and what does it mean for economic development. And I said, you know, honestly, all I know is the ag statistics for Thurston County, and I think what we need to do is talk to the farmers. And so that's where it started. We wanted to talk to the farmers, and we wanted to also talk to the buyers, food buyers, restaurants, grocery stores, produce stands, institutions, and explore what's going on with produce marketing and where there's some market opportunities in our area. And phase three, and really it's not just a phase, it wasn't the last thing, but throughout all of this, we did a lot of community engagement. We did a lot of, we did a farmer breakfast, we did a farm-to-table event partnered with Cascade Harvest Coalition. There's a lot of really strategic planning around this, strategic community building that was a part of this. And so, great segue coming after the farmers that presented. Dan was mentioning the 1% direct market sales. And so what this slide shows is where consumers are buying their food from. Food service establishments, supermarkets and other retail, farm and public markets. 98.5% of fresh produce sales in the United States of America are coming from everything other than farmers markets and public markets and direct to consumer. So we basically started by saying farmers markets are awesome, and in fact, they're gonna get more awesome, and there's some data to support this, but there's this tremendous market all around us that is maybe not getting, you know, sourcing local food from local farmers, and a lot of farmers might wanna be selling there. And so that's why we started there. And this slide is just to show that farmers markets actually grew between 2007 and 2010 by 12.5%. So farmers markets are very important and getting more important. But we wanted to focus with our study on those other market outlets that are a little less understood in our area. And here's another bit of context, and I bet you have very similar statistics for Pierce County. This is the average vegetable farm size in Thurston County from 1978 on the left side there to 2007. The average vegetable farm in 1978 was 40 acres. You see this massive drop off, and now we're at about 5 acres. Our study shows that that's actually not entirely true. It's a little bit larger than that, it seems, but it's certainly very small on average. So we have a lot of small farmers trying to access these big markets. How are we gonna do it? And then the last piece was Christine Gregoire, before she left office, had this executive order where she brought together 5 state agencies, and she asked the state agencies to look into gaps and opportunities in the food system. 2 major gaps and opportunities were identified as the development of small, medium scale processing and support of the development of food hubs. And so it's been identified at the state level that this is an issue, that a lot of the small scale processing that smaller farmers can access has gone away. And so how do we address that infrastructure gap? Heather, this is the last thing I wanted to kind of set you guys up with a little bit of context before I get into the study that we did. But this is a viewpoint published in Capital Press in 1983, saying basically exactly what we're probably saying here in this room today. This is a farmer that used to be in Rochester, is now in New York State. But small farmers are shut out of the market because big supermarket chains do not want to deal with individuals. They want to make one phone call to buy what they want, when they want, volume, consistency, and a year-round supply. So what we did is we looked at Thurston, Lewis, and Mason counties, and we asked some big picture questions of fruit and vegetable farmers, and then the buyers that we identified as sourcing food or being interested in sourcing food. And it did range from the scale of Hagen to, you know, Jay's Farm Stand in Rochester, or, you know, small retailers or a caterer, say. So of the farmers, we asked some big picture questions. We asked, what is the interest in different market outlets? What are the infrastructure needs of farmers? And then this idea of cooperation came up today. So what types of farmers are interested in aggregating and or jointly marketing their products with other farms to access markets? So that was a really central theme to us. Farms are getting smaller. There's not the infrastructure. So how are we going to collaborate with one another to get things done to access markets? I think that's just got to be the future. And then of the buyers, and we focused on restaurants, grocery stores, and institutions, we asked what types of regional buyers are interested in sourcing local foods, in what quantities, what kinds, and with what frequency, kind of that just basic logistics. Then we asked kind of how are they connecting with farmers and what are their general challenges in accessing local food. So what we did is we approached the USDA Conservation District offices, Chambers of Commerce, et cetera, to try to identify all the commercial produce farmers, farmer market associations, and we identified 74 in those three counties. We got a 53% response rate after sending a survey to them. That was really quite high for surveys. There's a lot of energy around this, just as there is here in this room today. Then we followed up with interviews, and that's me interviewing Brandon Best down in Lewis County. But we interviewed on farm 25 farmers, and we had a farmer breakfast as well. On the buyers, we identified with the help of all these kind of constituent food consultants, food system folks, we identified 41 restaurants, 15 grocery stores, co-ops, produce stands, and then 16 different institutions, ranging from higher ed to hospitals to Washington Corrections, that had some interest or some policy in place to purchase local food. We got a 42% response rate from that survey, and then we interviewed four of them as a group interview. So this is just a picture to show that we actually went out on the farm and spent a lot of time very deliberately establishing relationships. This wasn't just about research, but this was about creating that community and those linkages between people. And then we had this farmer breakfast, and 10 farmers ended up coming representing 8 farms. Olympia Port Commissioner came. Tilth Producers Washington rep came, and so on. There was a comment by one of the farmers, why does it always have to be Wazoo or this conservation district that holds these farmer breakfasts? And then another farmer stood up and said, well, if you want to organize it, please go ahead. But we haven't had a farmer meeting in a really long time in this area. So that was identified as just a huge need, just simply getting together and just chatting with one another. So this is where I get into some of the results, and I kind of mix in the results from the farmer side and the buyer side. I wanted to show you who the average farmer is in that area. The average farmer in our area that's growing fruits and vegetables is growing at a 29-acre scale of the total farm size, and about half of that, 14 acres, was actively in fruits or vegetables in 2012. So it's a little bit larger than that 5-acre statistic from the USDA, but still on the smaller end and getting smaller probably. 72% of the total cash receipts, the total gross income from farm came from fruits and vegetables from these farmers, so they were clearly dominantly produce farmers. However, 44% of the farmers depended on some of their income from herbs, flowers, and nursery stock. 33% of the farmers depended on some of their income from meat or animal products. So these are very diversified farms too at the same time. There's a lot of diversification. Then we really broke that down in lots of categories, and we have a lot of data there. And then the other interesting thing is that about 43% of the farmers earn less than $10,000 a year. Yep. Gross income. Gross cash receipts, yeah. Not net. We didn't ask net. We always ask gross. I'm sorry. And it's asking salary ranges is a touchy subject. So what we tend to do is we create ranges like the USDA does, because we don't want to ask very specific numbers. About one third of the farmers made 0 to 25% of their total household income. That was another question that we asked that I'm not showing there for the farm. And about one third made 75 to 100% of their household income from the farm. And so you have this huge division between the people that are making a little bit of their income and the people that are really dependent on the farm for income. And there's that gap in the middle. There's that valley where that mid-size maybe farmer, however we want to define it, is not really necessarily there anymore. Two-thirds of the farms that we surveyed are small farms by the USDA definition. And if you don't know what that means, it's $250,000 or less a year. Two-thirds of the farms are small. So we wanted to have everybody define for themselves what local means to them. But what we found is that 70% of the farmers consider local to be less than or equal to 100 miles. It ranged from like the Pacific Northwest region, or some even said USA. We have some berry producers that are big exporters. But 70% agree that it's fairly local, 100 miles. That's basically the distance between Chehalis Basin to Portland, which is basically the range of many of our farmers in terms of their markets, from Thurston County going down to Portland and up to Seattle. Now, we asked how much of your produce do you want to sell locally if you could. 87% there said that they wanted to grow 76 or 100% of their produce locally. And again, we let them define what that meant, but there's a tremendous interest in selling their produce locally. They don't want to take it out of the local area on average. Only 5% said none of their produce. And those, again, were those kind of export bigger farms. Now, we kind of got into market outlets, and we asked 11 different types of market outlets, kind of the traditional wholesale and the various direct market or direct to retail type markets. And we found that 88% of the responding farmers sell with some frequency to farmers markets. That's why farmers markets are tremendously important. And I'm going to show another slide that will show why in the next couple years farmers in our area are perceiving that they're going to get even more important. Direct to retail sales were already being made by 88% of the respondent farmers. So we had a little bit of a basis for us getting into the study, because that was kind of our question. You know, how many people do want to sell to retail and to restaurants? 88% of the farmers are already selling directly to retail. Farm stands, 64% of the farmers are selling to farm stands. Directly to restaurants and caterers, also 64%. So every other market outlet, either half or fewer of the farmers were engaging in that sort of market. So we really are talking about direct to consumer and these direct to retail, direct to restaurant type markets. Now, I'll just walk you through this. Sorry, this is one of those crazy academic slides that I just can't help myself with. But we asked farmers how often they sell to various markets, and we ranked it on a never to always scale, 0 to 4. And then those top ones are the ones that I wanted to really highlight. So farmers markets, 3.5, between often and always, they're selling to farmers markets. Very important. Also farm stands. But direct to retail market and direct to restaurant caterer, 2.9, 2.6, between sometimes and often, those are very important as well. Whereas you see some of those traditional wholesale marketplaces and the online marketplace was not important for our area. And I think that might be a little bit of an education gap. I think there's tremendous potential in online marketplaces for farmers. So it's interesting to note that not many of our farmers were engaging in online marketplaces. Now, we asked the farmers to tell us how they plan to expand certain markets in the next 3 years. And I kind of, we had different columns for, we want to get rid of this, we want to expand it, we want to decrease it. I don't know, and so on. But so I pulled together expand and startup as basically the growth curve. And again, the top three things are going to be expanding in the next 3 years, according to the farmers, is farm stands, farmers markets, and CSA. So those direct market things, the perception is these markets are going to get stronger. So there's something to this. The farmers are out there dealing day to day with their customers. So they see that this is still going to be getting bigger. And then the second two biggest ones were direct to restaurant caterer and direct to retail market. About 40%. So of the respondent farmers are going to increase those markets, increase their focus on those markets. So that's pretty substantial. Everything else, all those wholesale markets and everything, I took that out of this table, but only 12 to 20% of the farmers said they would start up or expand those markets. However, I think there's some potential growth in some of those. For instance, direct to processor. I think traditionally direct to processor, particularly in our area, meant the Chehalis cannery, National Frozen Foods. But I think that too is going to change because you see the development of kind of smaller scale processors, Ollie Kraut being one of them. There's interest in starting up a smaller flash freeze type operation in our area. So there's potential for different types of processors engaging directly with farmers as well. So then we asked farmers, what are your infrastructure needs? And we had a whole bunch of stuff listed out, and I kind of pooled the key findings together. But 51% of the farmers said that they had unmet infrastructure needs. And by far the largest need was cold and dry storage. And actually, we split those two things up, and cold storage was by far the biggest one. But dry storage was actually huge, and that has a lot to do with year-round production, or at least year-round sales, because you can store those potatoes or onions or carrots a little bit better for a little bit longer. Particularly in some of our river valleys that are dealing with some pretty serious flooding in the Chehalis area or Nisqually area. So having that dry storage is very important. Delivery, washing, cleaning, packing, processing equipment were all big needs as well. So here's that interest in collaboration. So this was very heartening to me. 64% of farmers when asked, would you consider aggregating and or jointly marketing your ag products with other farms to access markets, said yes. They said it depends. And we let them elaborate because there's a lot of things there. You know, can you preserve your farm's identity in it? If that restaurant wants to know, hey, I bought Rising Rivers produce or whatever. There's issues, GAP certification, you know, a farmer might not have that, might not have as good of a food safe product and you're pooling it together. So there are issues there, but there is interest in looking at this. So basically, this comes from the mouths directly of the farmers. I condensed essentially 25 interviews and found three common themes in there as like action steps for our area. The first thing is build the social network. Meet more regularly to share ideas and equipment. And some farmers said it's as simple as, I don't even want a workshop on the farm to talk about blueberry pruning. I just simply want to walk on the farm and look at what equipment that farmer has and then talk to that farmer. Where did they buy that piece of equipment? So it could be as informal as you want it to be, or it could be more structured and educational. Better use of what we have. We have a lot of infrastructure that exists within our region still. Granges have sometimes, unfortunately, fairly decrepit kitchens, but there's potential to build on things that are there, make them commercial grade spaces. Fairgrounds, for instance, in Thurston County, we have a kitchen that is very close to potentially being a commercial kitchen. It just takes the county wanting to invest in that a little bit. So there's a lot of stuff out there that we have. Let's identify it and figure out what sort of investments we can make in that because they're often way smaller than building something anew. But build new things came out big time as well because particularly in our area, cold storage is a huge issue. Over this last year, it turned out that because of the massive salmon harvest, nearly all cold storage was unavailable from here to Fresno is what I heard. I ended up calling a lot of cold storage looking for space for some cranberry growers. We couldn't find anything nearby. So this is an issue. So we don't want to say what that looks like yet. We just simply wanted to talk to farmers and hear from them and then say, we will help you address these needs. We will help create the public-private partnerships that might be required to address these needs. But right now we just wanted to gather this information. So this kind of goes over to the buyer side now. So we wanted to get a sense of how frequently and in what volume buyers are purchasing produce at. And basically, the moral of the story is they're buying very frequently, either daily or 2 to 3 days a week. 67% of their purchases were made in that fashion. Or 90% of the purchase sizes were under a case or by the case. So, you know, fairly small quantities in a pretty regular frequency. And so when you're thinking about something like a food hub or collaborating on distribution, this is an important consideration because there needs to be the capacity there to do very frequent deliveries. Of small volumes of product. So it's a logistical problem. Another one of those great academic crazy graphs that I'll have to walk you through. But we asked, how did you establish your current buying relationships with farmers? And then we had a whole bunch of information here. Maybe I'll walk over here. I'm sorry that it's not going to be with the mic. Is that okay?
Buying through
to them. Moral of the story, buyers are not going out to you. And then there's that blue box, and that's either a cold call or email to the farmers, a personal visit to a farm, or at a farmer's market. We thought actually the at a farmer's market would be much higher than that. There was anecdotal evidence that at the Olympia farmer's markets, there are a lot of chefs coming and forming relationships with farmers, but it's not that big. And so, again, it comes down to there needs to be that that strategic approaching of the buyers, and that's why there's place for these farm to table events. You know, basically that's what it is. It's bringing both parties to the table in this one place at this one time to do this. Interestingly, only 4% of the buyers ever connected to a farmer through an online marketplace. It's a little cut off there, and none of them in our area said that they attended a farmer or buyer event. And we crowned this entire project with doing a farm to table event with Cascade Harvest Coalition, and I'll get into that a little bit, but it was a huge success, I think, in many ways. And so I think hopefully that will change. But kind of condensed down, we asked, again, the buyers, what was the most limiting things to them in accessing local produce? And this is just really condensed down because there was a lot of information there. But basically, knowing who the farmers are was by far the largest issue, again. Problems with delivery or pickup of products, again. So again, that kind of logistical piece, huge problem. They ranked it really high. We kind of did the same kind of ranking scale. Not limiting was pre-existing purchasing contracts. We didn't know going into it if that was going to be an issue, if people had those relationships with wholesalers or whoever, but that didn't seem to be an issue. Products don't have certifications. Buyers in general did not tend to care if it was organically certified. Again, it depends on the buyer, but they did care that it was produced with ecologically sound principles. We split those two questions up. So there is this really strong desire for that ecological sustainability, but they don't necessarily mind organic or not organic, it seems. And products not processed or cleaned to extent needed was not an issue for them. So it seemed that many of the buyers, and we heard this again in some of the interviews and at the Farm to Table event, that different types of buyers are willing to buy all sorts of different types of produce products. It's quite a range. So, you know, crowning that whole process after we finished all those interviews and surveys, we in December, we held at the fairgrounds in Thurston County this Farm to Table event. It brought together 74 people. I think we had 16 farms and 13 buyers, and they were really a range. I mean, we had Olympia School District come, Washington Corrections, down to the scale of grocery stores and restaurants and a caterer and so on. It was something like this. You know, we had a discussion. We had a discussion of issues. We had a chef talking. We had a farmer talking. We had two processors talking from their perspective. I shared a little bit of the data like I'm doing today. And then we had this around the table. Basically, we set up a buyer at a table, or actually two buyers per table. So there, I think IGA Stormans is sitting there with New Yardbirds out of Chehalis. And then you have a couple farmers and processors just come and sit at the table, explain what they have. There's no product exchange at the time. Just this is what I have and what I could sell to you. And in following up with a couple of the farmers, there were some pretty major business deals that went down just on that particular day. So next step. So there's kind of two next steps. One is the next step for me down there, and then there's another next step for you here. So for me down there, I'm writing all this up into a final report. I'm behind. It should have already been released in late January. I'm sorry, but it will be released in this month. And we're putting together the comprehensive data. You know, all that data is going to be there with analysis. The other thing that's happening in our area is, again, strategically, we approach the port, we approach our Economic Development Council, we approach Workforce Development, we approach all these traditional economic development entities, and we said, let's talk about ag. And it's led to a number of things happening. The first thing is the South Thurston Economic Development Initiative, STEADY, is kind of a part of that. STEADY is not only about ag, but we're trying to weave ag as much as we can into it. And as a result, we kind of collaborate with all these rural municipalities, chambers of commerce, all these different folks, the port, EDC, all these different partners, and we wrote a grant to the USDA. And we hope that part of that grant is going to go towards business feasibility assessments of cooperative infrastructure. And we're going to allow the producers to define what that is for us still, because we don't necessarily want to focus just on produce. It might actually go towards the direction of meat or some other sector, but we want it to come from the community. And then we're exploring public-private partnerships. So we're creating something like an ag economic development consortium where all those groups come together and we only talk about ag. The whole space and conversation is about ag, so that we're not competing with development, you know, all those traditional economic development things that tend to tie up the EDC's time. Ag is tends to be a small part of the conversation. We really want to create a space where it's the only conversation, so that we could be a little bit more strategic. And we want to do it as multi-county. So right now we're just talking between Lewis and Thurston, but there's potential to maybe do this at a bigger scale too and be strategic. You know, we could go after some pretty big federal dollars. We could do things at the state level and make some demands and get some problems solved. The other thing that's happening in our area is a community farmland trust just purchased a Scatter Creek Community Farming Conservancy. They're creating an incubator farm in our area down in Rochester. It's another partnership between all these various entities, but it's just something that's kind of rolling down the pipeline. There's ideas, there's a lot of infrastructure on that farm. It used to be a dairy farm. There's a lot of actually really nice barns. So we're talking, and different outbuildings. So we're talking about maybe some infrastructure consolidated into that, a feed mill or whatever. And so that's part of the conversation. So what's next for here? Well, I've been talking to Pierce County. I've been talking to the Pierce Conservation District, and our hope is to do something similar to this initiative here. We're in the process of hiring a new WSU Pierce County Extension Ag Agent and County Director, and I hope to only kickstart this sort of thing for this area and then pass it on to this person when they get hired. But I think there's a lot of value to doing something like this, and again, it could be modified for local needs. So we learned a lot in our process, and we could come to the table and say, you know, this is what we did. How can we kind of modify this to get at the questions here that are pertinent? Oh, that's my last slide. Thank you. So I guess I'll just field questions. Actually, that was onions. That's down in down in Rochester. Yeah, that was really early season. I think I went out there, I want to say May. Yeah, I mean, they do between row cultivation too. Yeah. Yep.
Our North American neighbors will create something called agricultural land reserves for what we would consider tundra land up there. And they're actually, I'm just wondering, is there any initiative down here to actually recognize the resources we have here and to keep them functioning in a sustainable manner? So.
Could you expand on that a little bit? So you mean in British Columbia?
British Columbia. That's they, for example, family farms, or if they, like a quarter section or whatever, that you could only build, there'd be one farm, you couldn't subdivide it, you couldn't put it into 5-acre plots. It was strictly for agricultural applications. So
here. You know, I'm not going to get too much into zoning, but the zoning picture is very different depending on the county. I think all of Lower Skagit Valley is 1-on-40, Don McMoran, yes? And they did that in what year? The 70s. What we're finding is if you want to do something like that now, it might be a little bit too late. And so whatever was zoned as long-term ag in counties is basically where we're at right now. I know that's certainly the case in Thurston County. There are certain tools and mechanisms to perhaps incentivize further. For instance, ag tourism came up here. We actually asked ag tourism questions as part of this too. We think it is an important part of our economic landscape. And you guys are in a much better position for this. I mean, the amount of people in this county and the amount of people coming through this corridor, that is a tremendous ag tourism potential. But Thurston County created something called the Agritourism Overlay District, basically loosening some of the permitting regulations and fee structures around launching an ag tourism operation in rural county. And it really is about rural county, and it right now it encompasses all the long-term zoned ag areas in the county. But that's kind of an additional incentive that's out there. Yeah, and so very quickly, I see Fred rolling up there. But you know, another thing that we have, and I don't know if you have this here, but we have a conservation futures program that a little bit of our property tax money as a county goes into buying conservation easements or to fee simple purchases of farmland. Actually, that Scatter Creek was an outright purchase of the property. They didn't buy the conservation easement, they bought the whole property. Because in their ethic, they think that that's the only way to truly preserve farmland. So American Farmland Trust recommended that Thurston County double the amount of money going into conservation futures, but that's another potential that's out there. Our pool of funding, though, is quite small, realistically. Fred?
Well, thanks, Lucas. That was something along the line that I was going to mention, that our opportunities to get involved in purchase of conservation easements on farms to ensure that that farm stays in agriculture, is not developed in the future. NRCS through USDA has several programs, the Farm and Ranch Protection Program and the Grassland Reserve Program. Some counties have conservation futures. Mm-hmm. Skagit does a lot. Skagit's probably one of the leaders in Washington. If you start to look at maps in Skagit County, the lands that are permanently protected with a conservation easement is growing and growing, and it's going to be quite significant. So there are ways to ensure that some land will stay in agriculture without the threat of zoning that most landowners believe is going to devalue their property. So that's another tool.
I just have something to add, and I think maybe Ron, when he, excuse me. So there's a farmland preservation in Pierce County through transfer of development rights. PCC Farmland Trust has also focused a lot of their considerable effort here in this area. So there are efforts underway, as are there in most counties throughout the state. So there's a lot of tools. Certainly more could be done in terms of preserving the actual working resource lands we have. But we do have some tools.
I just wanted to add, too, that we also have Pierce County has a transfer of development rights and a purchase of development rights program that we do. Agriculture is the number one priority for preservation, as well as our conservation futures. Money does also allocate some, through an application process, has preserved some agriculture lands.
And we see these things change. In our county, the Ranking Committee for Conservation Futures has really taken an interest in ag, and it really went from funding primarily parklands and trail systems to farmland right now. And I think I see maybe something similar happening in Pierce County, where it is an opportune time to put more energy, I think, into ag. No other questions? All right, thank you.
We are going to head into food right now, but we would like to introduce you to Gallucci's Catering and Chef Tria Bias, if she would like to come up and tell us a little bit from her perspective how they're sourcing locally, maybe some of the opportunities and challenges that they have in providing local produce and the products that they prepare for different organizations.
So the information that I have, a lot of it's talking about how it's kind of harder for us, for catering companies, to use locally, local foods and things like that. It's more expensive. It's not as readily available. It's more expensive. So most of the time, whenever we use local foods and use local farms, is because a client has specifically requested it. So they know that it's more expensive. So a lot of people steer away from that, because we can go, if we're buying large quantities, we can go to Costco, and it's just a lot cheaper. And then the clients know that. So they know that they can get that food and produce for cheaper. So that's just one of the obstacles that we face. Today, the chicken that we got is from Draper Valley Farm in Mount Vernon. And the veggies are from Dan at Terra Farms. And let's see what else. So another thing that we face is a lot of the jobs we do are last minute. So whenever we have a last minute catering job, like we just got a catering job for next week. So it's hard to use local foods because it's harder for them to be readily available to us. We don't know if it's in stock. It's really, a lot of times it's harder to get a hold of them. They already have other things planned, and that's pretty much all the things that I have right now. We would love an opportunity to use more locally things. It's definitely greater for the community, and we'd love to do that. And that's pretty much all I have to say about it. And
well, thank you. And I think the people in this room are probably of the mindset to help you make it easier to source more locally. Thank you.
Thank you.
So, and just a note, I think one of the things that we've observed through all the farm-to-table trade meetings and things that we've done is that some of that price pressure that many buyers face when purchasing locally is really being addressed when we have a great mixture of and diversity of size and types of farms that, for example, in this county, you'll get Strino farms or stricter farms that have larger quantities that are selling into the system that can provide product at a price. And so it's how do we make those critical connections then with the caterers so that they can get a local product at a price point that they can afford. We're working with institutions that don't maybe face that price point, some schools, some hospitals. So the opportunities out there are really quite incredible right now, but it does take a lot of hand-holding. It takes someone or some organization taking the time to seek out those connections and create a space where people can have the conversations and feel comfortable and say, you know, the quality of product you're delivering me is just not up to snuff. And then the farmer being able to say, well, I can fix that. And so I think all of us here and for the conversations tonight and as we continue to move forward is how do we support each other in making these vitally critical decisions about getting local food into everywhere we eat. And so I think there's been so much groundwork and information presented today and more to come that will help foster those conversations and actually help realize this really vibrant food economy in Pierce County. So with that, let's start going out to eat in some managed way.